So good afternoon, everybody. I will be discussing a case of 13-year-old female. She presented in January 2015 with complaints of progressive abdominal distension, and it was mostly she perceived it in the upper abdomen, and there was no mass palpable as per the history. There was also associated poor appetite and associated fatigability. Symptoms for last 2 months.
Okay, stop there. So what do you think we might be dealing with here? Progressive abdominal distension, upper abdomen, poor appetite, fatigability. Sushant, what do you think?
A 13-year-old female is coming to you with upper abdominal. There is no mass palpable.
So according to the parents.
According to the parents.
Yeah.
So we need to go into more details. The examination, there might be a mass which is palpable. Because otherwise, apart from poor appetite and fatigability, there are no other symptoms. So I think you should go ahead and see for other symptoms. More
okay.
history.
So move on.
See, in the history also, there was no significant negative other history apart from the complaints I mentioned. There was no yellow discoloration or progressive pallor, suggestive of any progressive anemia, no diarrhea, abdominal pain or vomiting, no oliguria, dysuria, edema, which can suggest a renal involvement, no bleeding from any site, no skin lesions, joint lesions, which could suggest a rheumatological disorder, as well as no history of blood transfusion or prior hospitalization to suggest a chronic disease.
Okay, stop there. Sushant, would you want any more information in terms of history, or what is your mind working on?
Any past history of similar complaints?
Similar complaints.
Is this the first episode with which the child is coming like this?
So this was the first episode. Basically, she presented to a pediatrician with these vague complaints, and she was evaluated with these complaints. She was developmentally normal. She has not attained menarche, and she was vaccinated for AIDS. And in the family history, we found a significant history. Father was treated for AFB positive pulmonary cox 1 year back. He had completed treatment, which was taken for 7 months. And she had one younger male sibling who was 9 year old, and he was well. Dietary history also was adequate, not as per the history. She was taking adequate calorie and protein.
Stop. I'm going to ask anyone here like to comment on what differential might we be dealing here. So if you've got someone with fatigability and poor appetite and fullness or whatever, some impression of some distension in the upper abdomen according to the parents, and there's nothing really in the history that we've got other than the fact that there's a family history of cox a year back.
Girl child,
yes. So anyone? Any comments? Right, Sushant, what would you do now?
Yes.
She's not attending menarche.
No. So shall we move on? So we just we don't really have any pointers towards anything till we come to the examination. Fine.
So basically on examination, anthropometry-wise, she was normal and the vitals were within normal limits. On examination, she was found to have pallor. There was also mild icterus. There was no lymphadenopathy. Abdomen was distended, but soft on palpation. Liver was enlarged 2 centimeters below costal margin with form and consistency and a span of 11 centimeters. Spleen was also enlarged 2 centimeters below costal margin and firm in consistency. On cardiovascular examination, there was an ejection systolic murmur grade 2/6 in the left upper sternal border, and chest and CNS were within normal limits.
Geeta, what do you think now? I mean, the reason why the family didn't mention any jaundice because clinically also it was rather mild, so what comes to your mind?
So
there was no free fluid.
No free fluid.
So you have a girl who was apparently well till now. She's 13. She has not yet attained menarche. In today's day, it's an important history that she's still not attained her menarche, which would be just a delay, but it's important history out there. And she's pale, icteric. She has a systolic marker probably because of her anemia, and she has a firm liver, which suggests that it's probably a little scarred liver, maybe with sharp margins. So it is something which is going on for a while, and she has a hepatosplenomegaly and probably a fibrotic liver if you say that there are sharp margins, and there is no ascites. So the distension with this liver and this spleen is just a feeling, because there is nothing over here which points to the reason for distension which is given in the history. Yep. So this is a girl who is not feeling well, is icteric, has deteriorated in her long history and has just presented it to you.
Constitutional symptoms.
Yeah, that's what we have, right. Okay.
Any nodularity over the surface of liver?
No. No. The margins were sharp, but there was no lordy.
Go ahead. Jeet, sir. Go ahead.
So, on investigations, she was anemic, microcytic, hyperchromic, and platelet counts were a bit on the lower side with 1.13 lakhs. ESR was slightly raised, 21 millimeter per hour. And total bilirubin was 2.6 against direct of 2.2. AST, ALT were mildly raised, 116 and 123. Her GGT, ALP were normal, albumin was normal, INR was also normal, and USG abdomen and Monto was also prescribed by the pediatrician in view of the history of COX, because the possibility of COX was also kept at that time. So Monto was 13 millimeter, and USG abdomen, apart from the coarse and nodular liver, there was no lymphadenopathy or any other findings suggestive of latent tuberculosis. Yes.
There was some collaterals though, right?
And collaterals.
Collaterals?
Apart from the liver disease, there was no finding of COX.
Okay, stop there. Ashish, what would you...
So this history and this picture, is, I think I'm looking at a chronic liver disease.
Right.
I mean, that's definitely older child, chronic liver disease, long drawn history, lab very much suggestive. Doesn't look like the child has decompensated,
right.
But it's looking like I had to work up for a chronic liver disease at this stage.
Okay. Anybody has a difference of opinion? Any comments? Okay, so what did you do next?
So we worked up for jaundice as well as abnormal LFT. Her anti-HIV, IgM and total were negative. HBsAg and anti-HCV were non-reactive. Seroplasmin was quite low, 8 milligram per deciliter. And 24 iodine copper without challenge was very much high, 413 mcg per day. KF ring was negative, ANA was negative, and upper GI endoscopy was done in view of chronic liver disease. Which is sensitive of esophageal varices, grade 1.
Okay. So, Ashish.
Yes.
Would you be happy with this and make a diagnosis of Wilson's?
Well, mentally I would, but theoretically I would require a biopsy and hepatic copper. Because from my understanding and what I would look at it is, unless you have all three positive, I'm not 100% sure that I'm going to make a diagnosis of Wilson's. To my mind, I know this is mostly likely going to be Wilson's, but since the PT is normal, I would go ahead and do a liver biopsy and hepatic copper estimation.
Okay. Now, this is a very interesting point. So let's. This is something that I guess we're going to get different opinions on. So what does your next slide tell us?
Sir, basically, genetic testing was not done because of financial constraints and liver biopsy, they were not willing. So we went through the lesbian criteria and we made a diagnosis of Wilson disease as the child's score was more than four. And this is the criteria which has been laid down.
Don't be in a rush. We have to debate this. Yeah. Okay. So points of view here in terms of a family not willing for a biopsy. You actually have a low seroplasmin and you have high urinary copper. You have a clinical setting where it fits in. You don't have any evidence to suggest we're dealing with something else. Could I ask Abha and Dr. Thapa, because you were wanted to comment on this in terms of, would you want to do anything else? Family's not keen on doing a biopsy.
One is the copper of 8. I think the normal here is between 20 to 60. Seroplasmin
yes.
of 8 with
yes.
a normal between 20
yes.
is quite suggestive.
Quite
especially if your albumin is 3.5. In our patient, even then, even if there was severe liver dysfunction, you may get a, because liver also produces seroplasmin, which is a protein, you would not expect it at this level. So with that, and with a baseline urine copper, 24-hour urine copper 400 plus, I don't think I would insist on a biopsy. And I think we should stress that biopsy is not the gold standard for treatment or for diagnosis of Wilson's. We, time and again, we've been taught that we get many false positives and negative also. It all depends. If your needle was to hit fibrotic tissue, you will not get much copper and it could still very much be Wilson's. So I would be happy with this.
With
and,
this. Professor Thapa?
I think I agree with Dr. Abha. But I think since this is a child who is coming from a family, we should screen the family, sibs as well as parents for seroplasmin. At least we can pick up the case. And if there is another patient also, if there's no doubt about the diagnosis of Wilson's disease in this patient. I think we should go ahead with the treatment.
Before you go on to this screening, you want to say something, Seema?
I'm really, really thankful that Abha has picked up this topic of ceruloplasmin being low, and at the same time, if albumin is low, you don't expect the ceruloplasmin, to be... If the albumin is low, the ceruloplasmin will also be low, and then it becomes a difficult situation. So actually, in non-Wilson's, this becomes a very big issue. And we were thinking there's no data on this, so I was thinking all the time, that are we the ones who are getting confused about this? But actually, with your picking up this, it makes a lot of sense to us that maybe others are also seeing that when you have a low albumin, then to comment on ceruloplasmin becomes a little difficult. But in your case, the albumin was intact. Maintained. So you could comment on
Now I'm going to ask Mr. Wilson himself, because you've done more work on Wilson's than anyone else. So why would
what
you...
What is the score here?
The score here is four.
Which are the four?
You get... Bolupi.
Ceruloplasmin less than 10, that counts for 2, and urine copper more than 2 times of our limit.
Right.
Okay. I want to ask you this question because you and I have had this debate in the past also. Firstly, where can we measure liver copper? I'm not talking about this child per se. The practicalities of doing it, is it still happening? How do you do it? Because in the past, you used to organize it to bark and so on. So what happens? And secondly, why are you so keen on a biopsy? Fine, it's a good thing to have, but here we have a family that's not keen, and that's the reason why we didn't do a biopsy, because we would have done it anyway. So just these two questions.
Well, first question is, the question you asked me was before I knew that the family was not very keen.
Yeah.
If you want, what is the protocol? You need... Initially, we used to say 2 out of the 3 are required for making a diagnosis between KF ring, ceruloplasmin, urinary copper. That is no longer accepted. I made the first statement. In my mind, I know this is going to turn out to be Wilson's. But tomorrow, if there is a small percentage that it is not, and I have not done the investigation, which is easily available, a biopsy is possible, INR is not deranged, hepatic copper is possible. If the parents are not willing, that's a different matter. But if they are willing, I would like to go that, because if I'll have supportive evidence. We have seen in the past, urinary coppers are absolutely... haywire in India. Believe me, you can never believe a urinary copper all the time. You repeat this urinary copper after some more time and you may find low levels. So from your 4, you'll get down to 3. And then you will say that diagnosis is not possible. Believe me, urinary copper, if there's something very definite, like a KF ring, if that was there but a urinary copper was not high, I would still accept it, because you don't generally get wrong if you have a good person. But urinary coppers are absolutely crude, even if you're using AS in the best of the centers. So when it's borderline 4, and it can easily be 3 at any time, I would like to do a liver biopsy and hepatic copper. But if they don't agree, fine, I'll treat it.
Coming back to the copper, where is it done? How easily is it
we
available and so on?
At the centers here.
Okay.
I mean,
how well is it clinically correlated with the kind of findings? How well do you correlate with the liver copper?
In the last 3 or 4 years, or let's say a little more than that, it's reasonably well correlated. 5 years back, I would not be keen to do that. But
Dr. Sibal, we need to address upon the urinary copper also. What are the conditions in which we find urinary copper going to more than 400 micrograms?
It's 400.
That's very, very important issue. Yeah. Because other than Wilson, what are the other conditions? ICC we are not seeing at all.
Yeah.
And this, I think 8 years, 11 years old.
This 13-year-old, yeah. So
sorry,
won't have been ICC anyway.
So therefore, ICC, it's out straight away. So I think urinary copper and ceruloplasmin we have to take in account, because there is no other condition which will be presenting like this. And you have a coarsened liver, you have a splenomegaly, you have a portal hypertension, and so on. I don't think you'll find
it. Sir, believe me, you are in Chandigarh, you may be getting good urinary copper. In the private, outside that, urinary copper results are unreliable.
Okay. So the point is well made, that have an open mind in terms of Wilson's. Don't just dogmatically say, okay, it doesn't seem like anything else. But yet at the same time, honestly, getting a hepatic copper is not that easy if you're really out there, because you have to send the biopsy here. Very few people do it. I don't think we do it in PGI, do we?
In PGI we are doing.
PGI. So maybe 10 people in the country do it. So, that's a real challenge as well.
But we're not getting a good clinical correlation. That's what I'm saying. You're doing it.
Right.
That's fine.
Okay.
So that's the question, is whether you should be doing it.
Doing it. So
in this particular chart.
Just one comment over here. What Dr. Thapa addressed is, when you get urinary copper high, just take teaching point over here, is that when you have severe cholestasis, then you can get a urinary copper fallaciously high. This is just a takeaway point, that, and we don't have it in this girl. This girl just had a bilirubin of 2.2 and not a severe cholestasis. So just as Abha mentioned, when you have a very low synthetic capacity of the liver with a very low albumin, high INRs, your ceruloplasmin can fall a bit, not to this level, and copper in urine can rise when you have a severe cholestasis.
Right.
So child was started on low copper diet and dietary restrictions. Penicillamine was started at 250 milligram BD and then gradually increased to 500 milligram BD. And zinc was started at 25 milligram thrice daily doses.
Okay. So I'm going to ask Ashish this question because it's not really related to this case, but it's very pertinent to Wilson's. Now, availability of other medication when you run into problem with penicillamine, how easily cause differential? Your comments, please.
Well, penicillin and zinc are available. The only
I mean, if you can't manage with penicillin.
The only medicine that you can have is Triantine.
Yeah.
It's not made in India. It's available in India. You can get it directly from the company. It's expensive. One capsule of 300 milligrams of penicillin costs around 100 rupees now. It's gone up to around 140. So a day's therapy comes to around 1,000. So it's 30,000 rupees a month if you want Triantine.
And TM, is there any possibility
TM,
of getting it at all?
No. TM is not commercially available. The original TM, which was there, had a very extremely short shelf life. So the company stopped making it. Now the choline derivative, or choline thiamolybdate is coming out. Phase 1-2 trials have just started and the phase 3 trials will start next year. So it's another 3-4 years away.
Okay.
So we have only choice of getting triantine.
And what is the cost per day for penicillamine for everyone's benefit? Because you'll have the precise cost.
Around 10 to 12 rupees a capsule.
So triantine is a good, so we are looking at about 40 rupees versus 1,000.
Yeah.
So nearly 20 times.
It's very expensive.
Okay.
I'm just looking at that.
Sure.
How did you give that medicine?
Explain your protocol.
So, penicillamine was given 1 hour prior to the meal, and the zinc was given just 3 hours after the meals. And so the gap was maintained.
So how much time between the penicillamine and the zinc?
Sir, penicillamine and zinc, 4 hours, almost 3 to 4 hours.
It's almost impossible to give five doses, all of them 4 to 5 hours apart, and on an empty stomach. That means the child is never eating.
No, it never works out to four. It becomes much less. You end up giving the penicillin, right? And the zinc ends up...
That's the problem. I would rather not give zinc. You're giving penicillin and zinc with a gap of 2 hours. Yeah. Both are not working. Neither penicillin is working because half of it is binding your zinc. And zinc is not working because it is not working because it's already bound to penicillin.
So what's the ideal time according to you?
If you can't give it, if you cannot give multiple doses, just concentrate on the chelator. That's the most important. Give penicillin in appropriate doses. If you can manage one tablet of zinc somewhere or second... and the patient are compliant and keeping it properly, give it. Because both of them have to be given an empty stomach and both of them have to be kept 4 or 5 hours apart. How do you give it? So five
no,
doses
but you can give two doses of zinc and so if you give zinc 2 hours, two and a half hours after a meal, Ashish?
Yes.
No, but this is five.
No. Five is very impractical unless you have a very, very compliant
exactly.
Family.
So
that's
four is the maximum.
Four is the max, which is a very important
which
point.
It's also difficult sometimes. Single dose of
actually, Seema, that the doesn't really always do the job. You're putting your child at a risk because once a day is
single
not...
Single dose study that is gone, which has been published, which has been done is Triantine by the Mount Sinai people. Single dose of Triantine and they just 14 adults which have tested it and they published it. But it is not enough evidence to say that one dose works. It has to be spaced out.
But that was Triantine anyway, right? That was Triantine anyway. It's
but
not
let's
penicillin.
Assume that even for penicillin it works. Today, the more important medicine is penicillin. Concentrate on that. If you can give zinc along with it, give it. If you cannot, forget about it.
So
on follow-up, child was improving. Her bilirubin as well as enzymes started improving and settling. And the younger sibling was screened for Wilson's. And again, his 24-hour urine copper was 100 microgram per day. And serum ceruloplasmin 15 milligram per deciliter. In view of diagnosis of elder sibling, child was presumed to be having Wilson disease, and he was started on zinc therapy.
Okay, carry on.
I'm sorry, I don't.
Sir, agree. You know, please. You don't agree with what?
Go back.
On what basis was this child diagnosed to have Wilson's?
No. I think he has a low ceruloplasmin. Would you want to wait for him to develop florid Wilson's?
No. So when will you ever make a diagnosis? You will give lifelong. When will you disprove that he has Wilson's?
So tell me, how will you disprove it?
You have to do something.
Like what?
What I mean to say is, this is absolutely no evidence. If you're going to give the message that if a child has got a...
No, I'm not giving any message. 15, tell me a practical solution, Ashish.
Do a biopsy.
Well, the family doesn't want a biopsy done for someone who has chronic liver disease. They're going to get a biopsy done in a sibling who has no symptoms. We are dealing with someone who is not right up there in terms of listening to you in terms of what is ideal.
With what is happening there is you're going to put almost 25 to 30% of siblings who are carriers going to be put on zinc therapy.
No, no, I'm talking about this case, Ashish. I'm not making a generic statement. We have a family here. We have a family here with this picture. What would you do?
9 years, sir.
Nine years. How old is 9 years?
Nine and 13.
How? You can still go ahead and do a genetic test, which is not a mutation test, but haplotype analysis.
This is a difficult thing.
Do a haplotype analysis, yeah. And if the LFT is normal, it's unlikely to be Wilson's. He must most likely to be a carrier. That's a very
okay. So the point is that you definitely get the genetics done if they're not willing to do a biopsy. Okay.
There is a proven case. The parents do haplotype, not very expensive.
Okay, fine. So that's a good message to take home. Yeah.
Dr. Ashish, just one question. What is the role of doing a deep penicillamine challenge?
Deep penicillamine challenge in asymptomatic siblings has got very little role, unfortunately. The deep penicillamine challenge is usually positive when there is a lot of activity in the liver. The place where we really want it to work, like in the asymptomatic siblings, it has got very poor role. In fact, it is not even generally recommended that you do in asymptomatic siblings. Because very often you will not get that rise in spite of the fact that the patient has Wilson's.
Okay.
So in this situation, unfortunately, people would do it in this situation, but it's not a situation where you should be doing it.
Which means that if you do a deep penicillamine challenge and don't get a very positive report, it doesn't rule out a Wilson's in somebody where you're screening.
Yes.
Would you say that if you do an ultrasound along with this and look for coarsening of echo texture, that would be corroborative in a 9-year-old child?
If there's, in my experience, if you have a coarse liver on USG, almost always a symptomatic sibling has high SGPT.
Because it's extremely unlikely that you have Wilson's and you'll have normal enzymes in a coarse liver.
They will almost
kind of won't add up, no? The three dots
all
won't
the, all the neuro Wilson's, all Sorry? The neuro Wilson's, yeah. They never have high SGPT. They all have plumb normal LFT. Plumb normal LFT with portal hypertension with cirrhosis proven on biopsy. None of the neuro Wilson's seem to have high SGOTPT.
Yeah, we're talking about a 9-year-old here. So.
If you look at the asymptomatic siblings, they're 2 years and 3 years when you're not ideally supposed to do all the copper workup, their SGPT is still quite often drained. And that tells you even at that age, though you don't have the other evidence to prove it, that this child, you do it at 3-4 years and all your things are going to come positive, this is going to be a Wilson's.
Okay, move on. We have only 8 minutes left.
After 9 months, child was brought with low-grade fever for 1 month, which was intermittent, mostly undocumented, not associated with rigor. She also had poor appetite and weight loss, and mother also gives a history of bilateral neck swelling below mandibles, she noted two weeks back. And this was after 9 months of starting therapy.
Sushant.
Bilateral neck swellings below the mandible mostly could be a lymph node. On clinical examination, we need to see.
Go ahead.
So she has lost weight of around 4 kg with the last documents. And there was pallor but no icterus. Neck examination, bilateral cervical lymph nodes were enlarged, maximum 2.5 to 3 centimeters, and matting was present. Liver was 2 centimeters as documented earlier, and spleen was slightly enlarged in comparison to the previous documents, and it was below, it was firm in consistency. And there was no added sounds on the chest examination. So the possibility is here. After 9 months of therapy, we still kept a possibility of whether it's a progression of disease per se, or it's a drug toxicity of, due to penicillamine, or infection. As already mentioned, father had a history of pulmonary cox, which was treated around 2 years back. And the fourth possibility we kept was lymphoma.
Go ahead. I mean, it's basically you're dealing with tuberculosis in all probability. There's really nothing else that can fit in with a family history like this. The kid has lost weight and you have cervical lymphadenopathy. Move on to your next.
Cervical lymphadenopathy is a very well-known complication of penicillin, but usually it comes very early.
It's
an immediate hypersensitivity. It comes at any time, but usually within the first few days after starting therapy, it's more likely.
And the thing is, we've also lost weight. So, I mean, obviously, with a family history, we're thinking of a tuberculosis. Yeah, but I mean, if you add one unifying thing, then it's in all probability an infection. Sorry? Yeah, so, yeah. Right.
Okay. So FNSC was done.
Karunesh, you should be a little fast because we want to leave some time for discussion.
FNSC of lymph nodes were done, which was suggestive of acid, which was positive for acid fast bacilli, and based on this, a diagnosis of extra pulmonary cox was made, and child was started on ATT. After
do you want to go back?
We started her on HRE for 9 months. We didn't start pyrazinamide in view of possibility of hepatotoxicity, and LFT was being monitored twice weekly. On ATT, fever and appetite improved, but after 4 weeks of therapy, child presented to us with complaints of progressive adolescence for 1 week, progressive jaundice for 5 days, and increased sleepiness and irritability for 3 days. On examination, liver was enlarged, 4 centimeters, and free fluid was present in the abdomen, and child was having grade 1 encephalopathy.
You stop here. Geeta, your thoughts?
So this child has worsened after starting your antituberculous treatment, and it is probable drug-induced hepatitis superimposed over her underlying chronic liver disease. And we have very specific definitions, but somewhere you may go towards an acute on chronic liver failure over here. So with a jaundice, with a sleepiness, the child is becoming encephalopathic. Distension may signify development of ascites over there. So, and there is free fluid, as you have mentioned. So the child is encephalopathic, free fluid, and is worsening. So it's an acute on chronic liver failure kind of situation.
Yeah. Can I make a point here?
Yeah, Sushant.
I didn't get this thing of why was pyrazinamide not started in this child?
Basically, child also had already had a diagnosis of chronic liver disease.
Yeah.
And usually, we could have started, but usually it's advisable to avoid pyrazinamide because that's the...
Why am I asking is, because if you see any guidelines now, if you see the RNTCP has revised in 2015 or even the WHO, we have to give 4-drug AKT, not just for the resistance. See, hepatotoxicity can even occur with your isoniazid. It is not, it may occur more with pyrazinamide. We don't know right from the first which drug is causing hepatotoxicity.
Yeah,
can't take the chance of giving one drug less for a tuberculosis patient and proven that is AFB positive. Okay. As it is, if we start on AKT, enzymes are going to go up and we are going to monitor this child.
So what would be the ideal 4-drug regimen that you'd recommend? Let's not forget we have a child with chronic liver disease.
Yeah. So HRZE, if...
So you will give pyrazinamide to someone with chronic liver disease.
Well,
let me ask everyone else. Let me ask the hepatologists. If they actually have someone with chronic liver disease, will they be brave enough and actually give pyrazinamide? Dr. Thapa, Seema?
I will not give pyrazinamide. I may start with the non-pyrazinamide, non-rifampicin. Later on, add on rifampicin, which we do often with our children, but not pyrazinamide.
Or we can, instead of pyrazinamide, we can...
Especially not if there is jaundice.
That can we give.
We can have streptomycin in place of pyrazinamide if we are confused.
Ashish, your thoughts? Would you give streptomycin to someone like this?
Because it is invasive.
No, so would you give 4 drugs? Or would you be okay with 3? So, see, it goes... Yeah, and again goes back to one of those gray areas where 3 versus 4 in the setting of chronic liver disease.
Other drugs are concerned, levoflox, moxifloxacin. The guidelines strictly say unless and until you prove that the sensitivity is there, we are not supposed to touch these drugs.
Sure.
That is very important. We cannot touch the second line drugs unless and until we have a report.
Right.
So keeping in mind the invasive streptomycin as well as toxicity of pyrazinamide, we start a child on HRE. And differential diagnosis at this point of time, as ma'am mentioned, possibility of acute and chronic liver failure, drug-induced liver injury, as well as decompensation due to poor compliance.
Dr. Thapa.
No, there is now.
No, there is, sir.
There is
now. Now. At the LFT. What is the LFT?
There was no...
No.
Yeah, go.
No, your second problem. And the second...
You actually... Go next. Okay, just move quickly to Keep moving. Right, move to the, because we want to discuss the crucial bit on how is it that you actually manage someone with chronic liver disease, Wilson's, who's on ATT and has not developed jaundice and all kinds of problems. So what should be that's what we should spend a couple of minutes on managing these children. So what did you do? And then let's ask the house on what.
So we stopped antituberculous therapy for this child, and we waited till LFTs were reverted to baseline.
Okay, so let's ask everyone, is it all right to totally stop? We have a child who's got tuberculosis and who's gotten sick. Should we continue one drug? Should we stop? Wait for LFTs, and I really want comments. Ashish?
Never continue a single drug. we have to stop because
so,
the child is symptomatic.
So everybody agrees on that, that you stop ATT till we get some kind of a control here.
Just a question. Wouldn't you want to continue, say, ethambutol and add over here moxifloxacin or another fluoroquinolone and at least continue these two drugs? I do understand.
Yeah.
Because we do not know how prolonged this journey is going to be. The child has AFB positive tuberculosis. Would you like to still cover with
the two? The thing is, with AKT-induced hepatitis, it depends. If the child is symptomatic, like in this case, we definitely stop the AKT. That is anti-tuberculosis drugs, to substitute with second-line drug depends upon the clinical status as far as TB is concerned. If the TB is causing problem and worsening, we can't wait in such a child. We have to substitute with other drugs till you get back. Otherwise, we can have a period of 1 week. The TB doesn't...
The guidelines very clearly state that when you withdraw the drugs which are hepatotoxic, you continue with streptoethambutol and then slowly add on first ionized, then arsen,
yes.
Then pyrazinamide, if pyrazinamide can...
So I
don't see any role of any of your levofloxacins, moxifloxacin or quinolones, because there is a grave danger of creating resistance to even those drugs which we are requiring for MDR. So for God's sake, we should not use up these drugs where we can use other drugs.
See, our problem essentially is when they are at the end of the road with the liver, the renal, they are sitting on an edge with their renal dysfunction, and using an aminoglycoside over here pushes them towards that renal function faster. So we do not want to use aminoglycosides in these patients.
No. Strepto is pretty safe. We have used it for ages. I don't think it causes
so much
problem.
If you want, you can use ethambutol and streptomycin.
Okay, so you're recommending streptomycin and ethambutol is what? Sorry?
The guidelines say that if it is according to, it depends on the disease severity. If the tuberculosis is so severe that you can't wait, then you have to start.
Well, out here, the liver would have killed the child.
They are not life-threatening.
We'd carried on.
We can stop.
TB is not life-threatening. If you even stop the AKT for 2 weeks, nothing is going to happen to the child.
Okay. I just want people to comment on it in terms of, I think we've kind of discussed this, but I think very briefly that we monitor when we start on ATT 2 weekly. We see what happens. If they get into what looks like a drug-induced situation, then there are viewpoints as we discussed. Either we stop depending on how severe the liver dysfunction is, or if our tuberculosis is not so severe or life-threatening. Otherwise, you perhaps look at a regimen which has two drugs and then you taper,
yes,
and then you finally go back on introducing drugs one after the other, keeping your fingers crossed that that the child will do well. So what happened to this child?
One more point which I need to add here is, leaving aside discus, if a normal child, if we are putting on anti-tuberculous therapy, please don't do it LFTs every month. That is what people tend to do. Every month, it is absolutely not required because the enzymes are going to be a little here and there.
Yeah. One point is here, whenever we are choosing a drugs, select two bacteriostatic drugs and at least one bactericidal drug.
Absolutely.
That we have to keep in mind. When you're starting two drugs, so at least one bactericidal.
Keep moving. So your key messages, and then we'll just do get all the panelists to comment.
So hepatotoxicity is a significant adverse effect of antituberculosis therapy, and ATT is a leading cause of drug-induced liver injury and drug-induced ALF, at least in our country, where TB is very prevalent. Outcome is poor in children or adults who develop jaundice, ascites, or liver failure. Consider baseline LFTs for all patients. As per some guidelines, most guidelines recommend baseline LFTs for all patients. And if you have a suspicion of drug-induced liver injury, first rule out common causes before making a diagnosis of drug-induced liver injury. And once confirmed, all drugs should be stopped. As severe the liver disease, fewer the hepatotoxic drugs should be used.
Of course, we've just been told, according to the panelists, that we need to be judicious in terms of stopping all drugs or having to, because that really needs to be tailor-made. And normally in sessions such as these, we are always told by the organizers, you're over time, finish. But considering that our panelists are so superb and the audience interaction has been phenomenal, Abbas just signaled to me that we can carry on for 5 more minutes. So clearly shows that we are doing well. So I think we're going to open this up for questions.
So Anupam, quickly, I'm sorry, what happened to this child? I missed it in all that.
Back to that because we wanted to cover this. We stopped all ATT, started, what did you give? Ethambutol
child,
and
we waited for 3 weeks, LFT normalized, at least touched her previous baseline. and she was started on non-hepatotoxic regime, that is 18 to 24 months of streptomycin, ethambutol, and fluoquinolones.
Okay, because now you're going to have a debate about quinolines and whether you should or you shouldn't. When did you actually reintroduce the other therapy?
Sir, right now she is on this therapy and we were planning to start.
You could have also started HNR again.
Yeah. So 3 months only. No.
Abhi 3 months away.
What is the right time to be brave and actually start again?
Once you are left with a normal
Once you start.
And your patient becomes clinically okay.
So there isn't really a sort of a cutoff in terms that you need to wait for a couple of months?
No.
So you, I mean, even if 4 weeks, 3 weeks,
no.
So there's no...
Once your bilirubin and...
You're talking about, and I mean, we would still won't put on something which is hepatotoxic unless the bilirubin is normal. But once your LFTs are absolutely normal, you make the swap.
Okay. LFTs would unlikely be normal.
No, they'll start coming down the trend,
isn't it? Normal child is clinically okay, you can start.
So you move to your last. So any questions there? Sorry. Yeah.
Yes.
Right. Of course, you go on to... No, I mean, that's what we are asking. So, you'll start off with rifampicin and then you'll add INH. You want to start with INH and then add rifampicin?
INH and rifampicin can never be...
Well, there's some guidelines that actually recommend using rifampicin first. No, there are a few guidelines that say rifampicin first followed by INH.
INH first.
No, we use...
Sorry?
I'm more of an adult hepatologist, yeah. But we use typically rifampicin first because personally we find INH toxicity much more compared to rifampicin.
Okay.
The other way around.
Okay. Huh. Go ahead, sir.
In pediatrics, it's INH first, please.
INH.
Not rifampicin
so,
first. And the bilirubin rise is going to be high with rifampicin rather than with INH.
Different guidelines mentions different, but there's hardly any difference whether you start INH or rifampicin. What's more important, start with drug, increase the dose, see whether it's hepatotoxic with that drug or not, and then we stop.
Even the 2015 guidelines say that you don't start with half the dose. Don't start with half the dose because you may try to save the liver, but you will cause worsening of TB. So INH, you don't start with 5. The recent guidelines say you start with 10.
All these are expert opinions. Yeah. There has been no head-to-head trials. They are expert opinions.
No.
And they are
They are
British and American thoracic guidelines.
Indian. I'm talking about Indian. 2015 IAP RNTCP consensus guidelines.
So it's an expert opinion.
It's
a consensus. What I'm saying. These are all our consensus opinions and expert opinions.
Before, can I interrupt?
We have something to the opposite.
The guidelines are very clear, Vibhor. Let me put it straight away. The guidelines are, you stop the AKT completely. Let the liver functions normalize. Once the liver function normalizes, till that time you continue that E plus S. Once they normalize, you start with the least hepatotoxic drug. Introduce that for 2 weeks. See your hepatic status. Is it worsening? Yes or no? If it is worsening, you know, okay, fine, this drug is a culprit, I'm not going to use it. If it is not worsening, you add another drug which is a little bit more hepatotoxic than what you have introduced before. So the guidelines is you start introducing least hepatotoxic drug
and keep on escalating every two weeks. So name them.
And they are not mentioned in the guidelines which is the least hepatotoxic drug.
Right. So how do you speculate? The guidelines are kind of silent on the least hepatotoxic drug.
Also, there is a case control study that has mentioned all the three types and therefore there is no difference.
I mean,
so
we have seen that in some people rifampicin is not, whereas INH is, and INH is in some, and rifampicin in some people have PYs that are not doing nothing, you know?
So, to Rashid, please. Seema, Dr. Merchant.
I have a problem. I have a major problem.
You just have one problem? I think we've created more problems after this panel. We don't know the least toxic, hepatotoxic drug.
My problem
there is a difference of opinion on whether to stop all or to stop two. So, I think we have many problems that we've left everyone
with. My problem is, in 1970, we were discussing this with Professor P.M. Udani. And in 2015, 45 years later, I'm hearing the same thing being discussed. 45 years, we don't seem to have made any progress. When we started INH therapy, Ashish, you know, we looked at rapid acetylators and how the drugs were being metabolized by us. For 45 years, we seem to be talking the same thing. Whether I go for an infectious conference or a hepatology, I remember Dr. Udani teaching us, you know, you have liver disease, don't have liver disease, you give AKT, we used to call it AKT then.
Yes.
I mean, where have we gone? We're still talking for 45 years the same thing. we should have gotten some answers by now within our population. In these days of personalized medicine, we are still shouting which to give INH first or rifampicin first and what doses. I think there has to be a concerted effort from the part of the pediatric as well as the community to put this thing at rest. There has to be personalized therapy for ATT. That's my comment.
No, absolutely. I think if you look at world literature, there's a lot on the genetics of what drugs to use. And clearly with mutations, you can actually predict who's likely to run into trouble and who's not. Seema, the final points.
Just one little thing, because all this time that we are talking about the guidelines for normal children. Here we are talking of cirrhotics. So that decision, that kind of data we'll only get from the adults as of now. You should be using that data from adults and trying that,
I think, Dr. Thapa, this is perhaps something for the group to really, for the ISPGAN to study in and actually perhaps arrive at some guidelines. ATT in the presence of liver dysfunction, ATT in a child with chronic liver disease, because we have both of these entities. Abba, you want us to finish? Ashish.
As hepatologists, we have reasonably good experience using rifampicin in situ 1 chronic liver disease, that is the PFIC for pruritus. And a lot of us use it.
Yes.
What I want to say is, we have not faced problems using rifampicin, and this personal experience in that. So
that's true.
Yeah, but you're not, both of them are equally bad, but at least we have some experience. We have no experience with INH.
So to summarize, think of Wilson's, but have an open mind of other diagnoses. Really try and conclusively prove a good point made in terms of siblings. Go for genetics. Get the haplotype if you can't really afford the complicated genetics. If you sadly have a child who develops tuberculosis, manage judiciously. Keep looking at guidelines and then pray to God that you get wisdom to actually do this right. And as Rashid said, 45 years we are there. But there was an editorial, Rashid, a few years ago. I think it was in either the Lancet or the BMJ. It talked about progress in medicine, and it said it takes 50 years for a bad idea to go out of medicine and 100 years for a good idea to come in. So we've got 55 more years to go. Thank you very much.